Hello everybody, welcome back to my channel where skincare is all about progression over perfection because perfection doesn't exist. And welcome to another ugly news, some of the worst beauty news going on in the industry right now. And let's start with the downfall of the body shop. It has been a really difficult, more than few years for the body shop, and most recently they have announced that they're having to close down more than 50% of their brick and mortar stores here in the UK and have plans to close stores throughout the US, Canada and Australia. At first, I do think people were kind of surprised by this. A few years back now, they mentioned that they were kind of struggling to find an investor. Things weren't going so well for them. However, the body shop is one of those shops that have just been in kind of every millennial's life, I guess. You're pretty much guaranteed to find a body shop in every shopping center, every shopping mall. You know, it's my go-to place to buy somebody, I don't really know, like a gift set for a gift. But the body shop has been struggling for a few different years for a few different reasons. I think their integrity as a cruelty-free brand was questioned a while back when they were bought out by L'Oreal, who at the time were selling in China, where at the time products were required to be tested on animals. That is not the case anymore. But overall, they've just kind of struggled to stay relevant and modern, I guess. You know, we have the rise of natural brands like Lush, even Rituals. But Lush, for example, their stores have been popping up everywhere, usually opposite a body shop in most cases. And each year they grow, they launch new things, new interesting, exciting products for, you know, people who do enjoy an all-natural, zero-waste take on beauty. Whereas the body shop are like, you can recycle us, and do you still like white musk? We do white musk still. They just aren't innovative in any way anymore. Not only that, but as a brick and mortar store, the body shop are now competing with the likes of Boots, Superdrug, CVS, all places where you can get all natural, focused ingredients, cruelty free at fraction of the price at what the body shop has to offer. There is just no need to go into a body shop anymore. They definitely lost points with the public as well when they launched this, the body shop at home, which is kind of like how Avon Ladies used to work. And this was called out for having an almost predatory structure, almost like an MLM. However, when you go on the website now to this day, you see that the body shop at home has been closed. They say as part of the administrator's plans to support the body shop's return to financial stability, they have sadly confirmed the closure of the body shop at home, effective immediately. The UK ambassador program has also been closed. But overall, this is a financial issue and it's got a kind of complicated backstory, but the body shop's money trouble started when the UK branch went bust shortly after being bought out by investment firm Aurelius. That pretty much messed up the cash flow to America, Canada, Australia, and they're all basically now waiting on money that is owed to them from Aurelius. Everything is up in the air financially. So Aurelius owe Natura & Co. the money, who is the previous owner. This led to a major financial mess, basically making them have to reorganize the whole structure of their business, shutting down stores, laying off people, shutting down initiatives. And people are seriously wondering, like, can the body shop come back from this in any way? I personally don't think so. When you look at who's been buying the body shop every time it's been up for sale, each time it gets massively discounted. Natura & Co. bought the body shop for $880 million and sold it to Aurelius for only $207 million. That's a 50% discount. That's huge. However, the body shop is predicted to kind of live on as an online store only, which kind of makes sense now. Who isn't anymore? I think, speaking from experience as somebody who worked in Lush in my university years, I think Lush has managed to kind of withstand the closing of a ton of brick and mortar shops and surviving through COVID, surviving through so many recessions, because there's something about the store that feels interactive. It's a little bit pricey, but you get some affordable bits in there, but it feels like an experience. It feels like an experience, whereas the body shop feels like an overwhelming beauty store. It'll be interesting to see where the body shop can go from here. I think they'll be online for sure. I think they've got a lot of dedicated clients still, but I do feel they're the boomer, Gen X to millennial kind of, are Gen X millennials? I don't know, millennials above. I feel like that's the only demographic, and I don't think a lot of the younger millennials to Gen Z really care about them. Celebrity beauty brand JLo Beauty is being taken out of Sephora after collecting dust on the Sephora shelves, according to Sephora's subreddit. I don't think this really comes as a surprise to anyone other than JLo herself, probably. JLo Beauty first launched in 2021 and went straight into Sephora and has apparently just not been selling at all. And when I tell you, I have not seen a single person talk about JLo Beauty online other than myself. I reviewed one product. Usually when I review a product, it will be in my algorithm, like I'll see videos about it non-stop because, you know, YouTubers show me other people have talked about this product. That didn't happen with JLo Beauty because no one's talking about it. The search volume for the brand is also pretty dire when you compare it to other successful successful celebrity launches, like Rhode, for example. And I feel like this is a true reflection of how these celebrity skincare brands go, when you can tell the celebrity behind it really doesn't care about skincare at all. They use this fake olive oil story to market their products. The campaigns, the videos, and the pictures that accompany the launch of the brand were so heavily photoshopped, so filtered. Nothing about this launch was sincere. The brand launched alongside 18 other celebrity skincare brands in 2021 and really just did get lost in the crowd. I think people were already over celebrity skincare brands by then. And let's be honest, the packaging is so bad. It looks old, it looks outdated. And in an industry where you have to have mass appeal to so many different generations, and when you have to compete sat on a shelf next to the likes of Bioma, Drunk Elephant, Glow Recipe, CeraVe, you know, you can't look like this. Your packaging cannot look like this. I think it was pretty obvious that this brand wasn't going to sell. I think Rhode does really well because I think Hailey Bieber has a genuine interest in skincare, but yet again, Hailey Bieber and Rhode has been accused of copying another brand. Rhode has been accused of copying everything from Millie Bobby Brown's Florence by Mills. They've been sued for trademark infringement, and let's be honest, the products aren't massively unique. You see them in a lot of Asian skincare especially, but they do have a great marketing team, great packaging. Products are nice to use. So now it's Nudestix turn to accuse Rhode of copying. Under a post on Trend Mood's Instagram, Trend Mood posted this kind of like sneaky peek of the next Rhode product, which looks like new blush sticks. It's kind of been confirmed that it's a blush stick. And loads of people under this picture were saying, this product looks familiar. This looks like Nudestix blush sticks. And Nudestix then left a comment saying, we've entered the chat under the picture. Now, a lot of people were confused by this, by the picture and by Nudestix comment, seeing that the component, the packaging, looked very similar to the one that Nudestix uses. A few people thought that this was some kind of collab because we've entered the chat. It doesn't really say a lot. It was a little bit confusing. And then other comments were like the usual troll hate that Hailey Bieber gets. And also people being confused why Rhode were launching makeup so early on when they positioned themselves as a skincare brand. But most of the people thought that this comment left by Nudestix was the brand accusing Rhode of copying them. And it was kind of backed up because the brand founders were in the comment section basically agreeing, saying, yeah, this looks like our brand. In fact, they say it looks exactly like this one particular shade, baby something, I don't know. Okay, so I don't know a lot about makeup. That's my brother. And I don't know a lot about this Nudestix brand at all. They had some half decent skincare that I tried for a bit. Didn't love it. But let's be real here. These blush sticks aren't original in any way. Just because the packaging's black? I mean, the founders did mention that the shade was very similar, but look at all these shades. The shade isn't unique in its own as well. In fact, Anastasia Beverly Hills has the exact same component, but in a pink. And I don't think I couldn't find a whisper from Nudestix about this. Where were they accusing her of copying them? I don't know who came first, but it's all the same. Who cares? I feel like this is a bit of a non-issue, to be honest with you. Like, let's not pretend that you invented this style of packaging or it was original in any way, because it wasn't. It's not. Another point of this story is Hailey Bieber is known for posting, teasing her brand, and this is most probably a lab sample. This might not even be the final packaging. It might align more with her kind of like gray aesthetic of Rhode. Like, where's my, here's a lab sample of a new product I can't show you, but this obviously isn't going to be the final packaging. It's just in packaging to allow it to do its job while it's being tested, right? But this blush stick mechanism is a very standard way of delivering a blush stick. I think maybe Pixie is the only one that has something that looks slightly different that isn't in this like wrap like cylinder shape. Like, come on, let's not pick fights for no reason. Like, this is kind of a non-issue. What's a When Beauty Turns Ugly video without some surgery news? No graphic content though. An aesthetics consultant called Melinda Farina, known as the Beauty Broker on Instagram, had a post go viral recently for all the wrong reasons. This is a before and after of one of her clients, or the company she works for. And this client apparently went through a facelift, a neck lift, quad blepharoplasty? Blepharoplasty and a volume replacement. And the after picture is pretty amazing. It looks very good. Like, almost too good though. Like, he looks like he would have done as a teenager. And people notice this. People were kind of like not really believing that this was the actual real result. People screaming that this has to have been photoshopped. Kind of like this bulk around his neck, which would kind of allude to his jawline being changed shape or his neck being bought in. His skin looks like a little bit bit too smooth, too good. He's had a facelift, but his eyebrows are lower. Something's not adding up. Someone was actually so convinced that this was Photoshop that they claimed to run it through a Chinese app, they say, that claims to detect augmented pixelation from Photoshop and highlights that with green. The after picture was just green. I will say, however, these apps aren't that accurate at all. If you put it into Photoshop, resized it, spread it onto a different canvas, if you used apps maybe to brighten the picture, it's gonna flag several things. When asked to comment about the accusations, Farina said, "This photo is not Photoshopped. We simply use a layout app to place photos side by side, then our size to fit the Instagram window." She said, "It's just an amazing result done by an amazing surgeon." I mean, it's almost too good to be true. And in my experience, my opinion as an editorial and advertising photography graduate, I think there are definitely some signs of tweaking in this image. Listen, brands are done with Gen Z. They don't care about you anymore. They got their money, they've shoved some neon on their packaging and some bubble font, and they're done with you. Have it. They're moving on to Gen Alpha. Already moving on. Beauty brands are already recognizing the purchasing power of Gen Alpha, who right now, the oldest age is 11. Purchasing power at the age of 11? I don't think I made purchases when I was 11. I don't think I had any money to purchase. Like, I'd maybe get like a pound pocket money to buy like some fruit pastels or something. You know, I wasn't purchasing anything. I had no power. But the Sephora kids were more than just a one-off phenomenon that just happened in Sephora. It, you know, leaked throughout the beauty industry and was happening way before the Sephora kids. Their purchasing power in the beauty industry is huge. And this has raised a few important questions in the beauty industry. How do we sell to Gen Alpha? How do we get their pocket money? When speaking to the Beauty Independent, Ruba Tadros, co-founder and creative director of Monolith Collective, made a really great point, basically saying that Gen Alpha's parents are millennials. So it's possible that we're going to see a millennial influence on the new generation. It could be the minimalism that shaped millennials' more intentional design, which makes sense because we look at the brands that Gen Alpha really like, and beyond Glow Recipe and Bioma, Drunk Elephant? What was it about Drunk Elephant that Gen Alpha likes? What is it about Glossier? These are all brands that were popular amongst millennials and that very minimalistic design. They're so millennial. Robin Marshall, partner and VP of strategy at Case, also makes a great point that Gen Alpha's online life is just as real as the physical life. And this kind of gives them infinite inspiration. So if something doesn't work, she says, they caught an era and move on. And it's kind of reflective of that TikTok trend kind of thing where like, there's a trend for a second, then you move on. Drunk Elephant, move on. Bioma, move on. Not that people have, but you get what I mean. Like there's this constant cycle of trends and then you have one era, then you move on to the next. And it's just, I feel like it's going to be more difficult for brands who have like a personality and a distinctive design, an iconic kind of look, because it's going to start feeling like they constantly have to chop and change to keep up with the forever changing trends. And whilst millennials and Gen Z really made a stride to support more environmentally friendly brands and brands that align with their own political views, there's this kind of fear that Gen Alpha won't care about this at all. And because they're grown up mainly online, they're fed this constant idea of having to mass consume all these products, beauty products, skincare, from social media platforms like TikTok. So I think everything's a bit up in the air at the moment, but can we give them like another 7 years? Like purchasing power. 16. No, I don't know. I don't care. Let me know what you think about today's stories in the comments down below. You can watch some more When Beauty Turns Ugly here, some general light entertainment here, and I'll see you over there.